like gasoline, like gasoline.
What's happening, everybody? Welcome to Last Call. Nice to see you. Thanks for staying up late. Carson here in my hometown of Santa Monica, California. I'm at Lula's. This is a fine Mexican establishment if you're in the area. Great tequila. More on that later. All right, let's get to tonight's show. I'm really excited. If you're a music fan, I think you're going to appreciate what we're doing tonight. We're devoting the entire half hour to one of the biggest bands to emerge out of Los Angeles from Los Feliz, California, in a long, long time. Their name is Airborne Toxic Event. They were on our show, made their TV debut last April, and their song Sometime Around Midnight has since become huge. In fact, it was named Top Alternative Song by iTunes of 2008. Here's more on Airborne Toxic Event. You wanna run away. In the summer of 2006, an aspiring novelist from the LA neighborhood of Los Feliz met up with four musicians to form the Airborne Toxic Event. They combined an exciting live show with the digital word of mouth provided by popular music blogs to quickly build a large and devoted following. By year's end, they had established themselves as one of LA's most exciting new acts. In January of 2008, they landed a residency at Spaceland, a gig that helped launch the careers of other LA bands like the Silver Sun Pickups and Cold War Kids. Simultaneously, three of LA's most popular radio stations and several more on the West Coast added an unsigned Airborne to their regular playlists, transforming the band from local indie favorites into one of music's biggest buzz bands. Like you've seen a ghost. In the last year, the band has signed a major label deal and toured throughout the US and Europe. Their song Sometime Around Midnight has spent 40 weeks on the Billboard Modern Rock chart, and their self-titled debut album hit number one on the Billboard Heat Seekers chart. So there you have it, a little more on the band. I'm gonna head into Lula's, have a little drink, talk to them all in just a minute, but first let's start with some music. They recently did a show at the Glass House down in Pomona, California. We sent our musical production guys, these fellas here with these cameras. They do an incredible job. We sent them down there to capture them, and let's get to some music right now. Airborne Toxic Event, here they are performing Sometime Around Midnight, their mega hit on Last Call.
Thank you.
Hand should go here. It's a little creepy. Some good music there. That was from the Glass House down in Pomona, California. Really cool venue. And that's what the show's all about. We're spending the entire half hour with Airborne Toxic Event. In fact, we'll take a break now. We come back. I'm going to sit down with them, see what life has been like in their crazy last year of success as they are rocketing out of the stratosphere. All of that's coming up, plus more music. The entire show, Airborne Toxic Event. From Lula's, great Mexican spot. We'll be right back.
Hi, Carson Daly. We're recording this on the new flip camera that you just gave us. I hate to break it to you, but you're never going to get this thing back.
Sorry,
sure, just wear the vest.
You should just wear the vest. And there's no shirt.
I'm sorry,
and there you have it. That's the gang right there. Airborne Toxic Event, one of the huge breakout artists from Los Angeles for the past year. Great band. And they provided us with a little exclusive backstage footage from one of their shows this past weekend. And they're super, super cool people. I had a chance to sit down and discuss the finer things and what it's like to be in Airborne Toxic Event throughout their meteoric rise of the last year. Take a look.
And the funny thing is it has no end. I try to call you up at 2 a.m. in a crowded bar, your ringtones grab my mind, I can see you through the vent.
A lot of this will just be because you're the whole show tonight, which we don't do a lot of.
It's really flattering. Thank you for doing that.
We heard it. We couldn't believe it. We were like, oh, like
we don't deserve it.
Well, our audience loves, you know, to discover new music, and you've been one of the great new music discoveries, certainly in the last year. And I remember when I was filling in at K-Rock, whenever that was, and there was this big buzz about the band. And then you guys did our late night show and made your debut there, and then it's just been...
That's right, we've been debuting with you.
When your friends say, what is it? You look like you've seen a ghost.
You remember that
number? I was so nervous for that show.
It's the first time we were ever on TV, let alone performing on TV. Like, we were like... And I remember it was like you got locked behind the stage, and I felt like that scene in The Right Stuff, where
the slow mo,
where they're walking towards the capsule, and they're like 900 feet up. It was like that. We're like,
is that why you were carrying that helmet?
It's weird. I had a spacesuit on, and they were like,
let's take us back to how you guys got started.
We actually started in Los Feliz. I'm from Los Feliz, and I was a writer, and I was working on a book, and instead of writing the book, I ended up writing a lot of songs, because I don't know if you've ever tried to write a book. It's really boring.
No, I haven't. What were you writing a book about?
I was a novel. I'm a writer. I was like a fiction writer and stuff like that. So I ended up writing all these songs, and then after about a year, it was pretty much all I'd done. I hadn't really worked on the book the whole time. And so I thought I should get a band together. So I met Darren first, and Darren was just like this punk rock drummer from Fresno. His email was one imaginary boy at whatever, you know.
Right.
Which is like a Cure reference, and I like fell in love immediately.
How did you meet Steven and Anna? How did you guys call him?
Steven and I had actually been friends for a long time. We've been friends, we're both writers. Steven's a writer in his own right. I didn't know he played music at all until I told him I was starting this band. And he was like, oh, I play guitar. And then Anna, we were at this place called El Gran Burrito, which was like late night drunken tacos, you know, that kind of situation.
Yeah.
And I was like, I was kind of drunk, and I was like, ah, don't you play like Bueller's that, you know? And she was like, yeah, dude. I was like, yeah, man, I've started this band, and I'm looking for a string player. She's like, whatever, man.
I quit playing violin. I was classically trained through college, and I totally quit when I moved to California. And then we linked up and just started playing together kind of casually at first.
Well, I used to have these happenings at my house because I would have, like, I had this apartment. Because I never had anywhere I had to be. So I'd have these happenings. I'd just have people over that played different instruments, and we'd put a bottle of whiskey in the center of the room, and we'd pass it around, and we'd learn a song, and then we'd try to record it by the end of the night.
Do you think that any of the writing that you had plays a part into the theatrics of these songs?
You know, there's a lot of posturing in rock and roll. There's a lot of, like, you know, you stand up and you're, it's almost like there's a sense you gotta be cool. It's like, I don't know if Mick Jagger started it, is it Elvis? I don't know.
It's like, it's just intrinsic to rock and
roll.
Yeah, right.
Where you get up and you start, you know, like, and then, I mean, I think from the start there was definitely like, you know, that. We don't care about that. We don't really wanna be like that. And there was something about just like, the honesty of just writing things that really happen. I mean, and there's a lot of that in literature. There's not a lot of that in music.
When I was at K-Rock, there was so much buzz on you guys. Take me back to that time when you weren't signed and this local, your local powerhouse radio station starts playing Midnight and it starts reacting.
I mean, we were already playing for like decent-sized audiences, and it was like a thing to come to an Airborne show, and some of the people who would come to the Airborne shows would be radio DJs.
Right.
And then, so when it started, like, we never thought anything of it. We never thought, like, we're gonna actually be on the radio. We thought at most we might be some sort of underground phenomenon. We never thought we'd live in this world of, like, television and interviews.
When that happened, what did that feel like?
It felt like being strapped to a rocket ship.
And this, and you're still like, on that exactly, rocket ship.
Yeah,
and this is
sure.
All very recent.
It's accelerating. It's actually getting faster. It's weird, because we didn't know
where
what
else
to
does
do.
That rocket ship take you? I mean, it takes you from your shows locally to the K-Rock, to touring, to getting signed, to South by Southwest, to 300 people coming, to 500 people coming, to having vacancies, to having to turn people away, to going to Europe. You just got back.
You just described
you're still on this rocket ship, right?
All right, now.
What is your family
keep going,
thing?
Keep going. The cocaine, the hookers.
Yes, that's right. Where's the behind the music?
Let's go. People keep saying, is this like your dreams coming true? And you're like, kind of, if it was like you were like on a like speeding bullet train through like the valley of your dreams and you're watching them go by like outside the window or something.
Right. So many bands have gotten to this point. A lot of heat, played Coachella, played South by, done a European
fell on
tour.
Their face, right?
And,
just completely fell
and
off.
Had that behind the music turn of events when we get back.
Yeah.
Mikkel ran off with the hookers and the blow.
This
and never spoke to Steven or Anna again. How does this band avoid that?
After this interview, Mikkel went out and did heroin and disappeared for a year.
I mean, do you guys sit down and talk about that as a band?
Yeah, we take it.
What do you
seriously.
Say? Tell me a little bit about
Well, for one thing, we actually have a no cocaine policy in the band. Like,
literally.
Which sounds stupid, but it's really true. We really do. And none of us really would do cocaine anyway. But, like, heavy drugs are what breaks up bands 95% of the time.
But do you think if those bands had that rule, they would have been okay?
Maybe. I just think maybe they had an attitude that was, like, we just don't think like that. We're like a group of orphaned, you know, siblings that have crash landed on an island, and now we're trying to make our way, you know, and live. That's like that's kind of how we function. You know?
Well, you make it look easy. Thanks for your time. I appreciate it. Great people right there. We had a really, really good time. I want to thank Mikkel and Steven and Anna, and the other band members showed up a little bit late, but it was great to hang out with them. We'll take a break. When we get back, you're going to get another performance from Airborne Toxic Event right here on Last Call.
Is for working Americans.
Hey guys, welcome back to Last Call. We're spending the entire show with a great young band from LA, Airborne Toxic Event. They did their TV debut with us last April and have gone on to great things since, so we wanted to catch up with them and show you some performances and talk to them. And we've got another great performance for you right now from their performance at the Glass House down in Pomona, California. Here they are, Airborne Toxic Event with Does This Mean You're Moving On?
I guess it's that kind of night. How you doing over here? I'm definitely gonna eat you at some point. I'm gonna tell you guys a little story. It was really tough at the time, but it's fun to sing about. It goes like this. And the funny thing was that I had no end. I tried to call her up at 2 a.m. And some crowded bar, a ring of tones. Got in my mind, I could see her through the phone. The phone, the phone. Lying wide awake at home, at home, at home. So I, hey, I'll call my cocaine. And I hope she won't catch all this vodka on my breath. My breath, my breath. No, it really happened, I mean it. Caught a cab outside on 7th Street. And the cars flew by through the Bowery. To a door and I heard them all. And another boy. Alone, alone, and my heart sank like a stone, a stone, a stone. And the tears wouldn't even come, cause I felt so numb and swept aside and dumb and dumb and dumb. When the words were wrong and my patience gone, will you tell me, did this mean she's moving on? Alright, come on, Pomona. You can jump around with us, we're honest about you. She called my name, I saw her standing in the rain. Her words so dry and her face so wet. She said I broke her heart, but that hadn't happened yet. I'll bet her friends all hate me now. I get the strangest looks from that fishy crowd. And though they must think they have a reason to, I guess I'm just not quite yet over you. When the words were off and she's hanging on to my other guy's arm, does this mean she's moving on?
All right, there you have it. Airborne Toxic Event from the Glass House in Pomona. We'll be right back to close things out from Lula's right here in Santa Monica right after this.
Just today.
Thank you, guys. Thank you for watching. Thanks for staying up late. Thanks to everybody here at Lula's in Santa Monica, California. It's great if you're in the area. Check it out. Also, of course, most importantly, thanks to Airborne Toxic Event. Great, great guys. Look for them. The album is self-titled. It's out now. If you don't have it, pick it up. They're also on tour right now, so look for them coming to a town near you very soon. That is our show. Good night. Also, thanks to the Glass House, too, in Pomona for being so cool and letting us come down and shoot that. I'm done. We're good? Everybody good? All right. Thanks, guys. See you later.